I would like to share once again the words from the open book, words by Annie Dillard. Why do people in church seem like cheerful, brainless tourists on a package tour of the absolute? Does anyone have the foggiest idea what sort of power we'd likely invoke? Or, as I suspect, does no one believe a word of it? The churches are children playing on the floor with their chemistry sets, mixing up a batch of TNT to kill on a Sunday morning. It is madness to wear lady straw hats and velvet hats to church. We should all be wearing crash helmets. Ushers should issue life preservers and signal flares. They should lash us to our pews. For the sleeping God, they may wake someday and take offense, or the waking God may draw us to where we can never return. It's a powerful statement. It's a statement that harks back to the prophets of old. Now, the prophets of old may be found in the Hebrew scriptures. There's Micah, there's Amos, Jeremiah. And the prophets are generally people that are glossed over at best. More often than not, they are unread. Because the prophets are really loose cannons. These are individuals who spoke truth to power. People who were shepherds, farmers, who dragged themselves out of their fields and presented themselves in the high halls of their day and spoke to the priests and the leaders of their day and said, there's trouble. There's deep trouble, and there's going to be a doom. And it's because God is angry, God is offended. You may well suppose why such prophetic words are not often spoken in churches, whether unorthodox flocks like ours or the more orthodox, because they point fingers. And they say that there is something powerful moving, a spirit moving in the wind, and that doom is coming our way. And yet our tradition, Unitarian Universalism, calls us all to be ministers of the Spirit, and in particular, a prophethood of all believers. This is very different from other traditions that focuses on the priesthood of all believers. Now, the priesthood are the people who oversee the rites of passage. They're the ones who, in times of great personal distress, hold your hand and help guide you through moments of great crisis, or perhaps during moments of great joy, are there to also guide you through that. It's a very different thing to be a prophetic voice. And the prophetic voice in our movement is not something reserved only for those who stand in the pulpit for 20 minutes or so on a Sunday, but each one of you is encouraged to be a prophetic voice. What does that mean? It means that now, as in days of yore, there are always troubles. There are always acts of social injustice. Not just personal crisis, but evils afoot that go deeper than one individual's being. Most of us are aware of different things that are stirring in this world. There is war. There is poverty. There are broken institutions. Not just here on this continent, but sweeping over the world. And no doubt each one of us has different causes that we resonate with. And so we perhaps contribute some time, perhaps letters, perhaps even money, to further those causes, to hopefully bring some relief to persons or places that we've never even visited. And I assure you, those are worthy endeavors. Some of us are impatient. Some of us like to see immediate results. Certainly, there are seeds that we can plant, as I mentioned to the children, that in one season will begin to burst through the earth and to show flowers. And for people who are impatient, it's a reassuring sign. But there is so much work to be done, and so much work which cannot be accomplished in one lifetime, perhaps not in the lifetime of several generations. Now, the prophets of old were underappreciated. They were hated. They were people who said, for example, I despise your festivals. This kind of rhetoric challenged authority of the priests and of the kings of their day. And they said that the true purpose of religious gatherings is not really to celebrate and to have offerings and sacrifices and pageantry, but it's something much more powerful. And that we are the ones who must lift ourselves up and respond with power. And power is an interesting word. It's a word that we just shy away from. And we would just as soon say, someone else has power. I'm just me. I'm one person. What can I possibly do? There are so many others who have power over me. I am but nothing. And the prophets would remind us, that's not entirely true. Many of us have our blinders on. And we follow the news, and then we move on to something more entertaining. And perhaps we might dream our dreams and be haunted by all the things happening in the world. And we feel so powerless and so insignificant. And so we deliberately remove ourselves from that larger conversation and absolve ourselves of any responsibility of having a role either in the cause or indeed in the cure of some of these larger issues. Now on this day, as we approach Easter, as we approach Passover, many prophets will be lifted up and certain passages will be shared. But more often than not, the prophetic passages will be the prophecies. Such and such will occur. And many of us would love dearly to have the power of foresight, to be a seer. But what about the power to be a prophetic voice? The title of the sermon is Practicing What We Preach. And I must confess that there is nothing easier than to talk. Actions speak louder than the words we say. And we are a tradition that lifts up our deeds rather than our creeds. And so the power is something that I, as well as you, have in my hands. And I invoke myself as much as anyone else to act according to what I might say. But to take action is to take a risk. And risk is something that those who gather in congregations and churches and temples and synagogues often shy away from. And so more often than not, we come expecting something very comfortable and very pleasing, rather than to be challenged. And so Annie Dillard says, the proper headwear in a church is not a soft hat, but a crash helmet. And the usher should be passing out life vests, because we are invoking power. And heaven forbid that the power should respond, that something should awaken. And we should realize that we have something within ourselves that is truly wondrous and wonderfully powerful. But that requires an incredible risk. To step outside of our shells and to step beyond rhetoric and to do something powerful. In our tradition, we have individuals who have written books on this subject and have preached ad nauseum on this topic. But one of the most telling authors is James Luther Adams, and he wrote a book called The Prophethood of All Believers. And he tells us that there are many false prophets in the world who say that there shall be peace, and that everything is going to be okay. And James Luther Adams says that those are the false prophets, because there has never been peace, and there never will be peace, and everything has never been okay. And if you're honest, everything will never be truly okay. And that if we lull ourselves into complacency, we are disengaging ourselves from the task that is truly called on us. And in the reading today, it concludes that we are all called to be ministers. And that is the great message of this religious movement. We are all called to do something, to share something. It's a potluck banquet, if you will. And many of us have different gifts. Some the gifts of words of encouragement, others the gift of using their hands, of attending rallies, of organizing rallies, of using the internet, of making ourselves heard, and of bridging all the gaps between isolated individuals and forging covenants of groups. And that really is the genius of this movement and other like movements, of creating groups, voluntary associations that are committed to an ideal and committed to action. And that is the genius of this movement, and that's why this movement continues to exist and to flourish. If all we had to offer for the last 200 years of this movement were words and books, we would have very little indeed to show. But the people that we remember are those who took risk and forged ahead and made those connections with other individuals, those covenanted groups, those voluntary associations that did the dirty work. The metaphor, of course, is to plant seeds. And there's something to be said for that. But it's a metaphor. So I'm not going to tell you what you should do. Rule number one in ministry is don't should on the people. But I invite you to look into your hearts and see how you might be more engaged in this world. What are the causes that move you to tears, that make you tremble? Tremble with anxiety, tremble with fear, tremble with pity. Those are the causes that I would invite you to look into your heart of hearts and see, is there something more that you might do? In this world, there are many causes and many organizations that already exist. By virtue of the internet, we can easily find those groups. And just as the prophets of old spoke truth to power, I would invite you to look for opportunities to do so in your own way. To find a cause, to speak truth to power, and to invest your life, your resources, your talents, to furthering that particular cause. And to realize that you truly have power, individually and collectively. We have power. And power is not something to be scared of. It's something to be used. And heaven knows that many religious liberals shy away from power because we know far too often power has been abused. It has been used in certain ways to oppress people, or the people who have wielded power have been corrupted. But I assure you, if you do so and keep connected and grounded in a religious community with your ideals and are open to other voices, you can use power responsibly. use power creatively, use power correctly. And perhaps when we do so, we will plant seeds. And some of those seeds we might see flourish in our lifetime. But more likely than not, we will plant seeds, or perhaps we will even tend seeds that others have planted. And we will further this process of movement towards social justice. Martin Luther King is remembered for a quote that the arc of the universe is very long, but it bends towards justice. And that quote, you may recall, may be attributed to Theodore Parker, who was one of the radicals of the early 19th century. He was so radical that he was asked to leave the ministry. But he refused. And he continued to do his work. And he continues to inspire our generation. And just as surely he will inspire the generation that is to come. We know that many who have been gardeners of the Spirit, who have encouraged us to think that we are better and more powerful than we credit ourselves, have been cut down. Last week, of course, we remembered Martin Luther King, who died in April 4th. And perhaps we remember other voices who rose up and encouraged us to be better than we think we could possibly be and more powerful. And to share the vision, and not just talk about it, but to further it. There are risks involved. But if we're truly going to be religious, we must observe not just the pastoral part of ministry, not just the priestly element, but also the prophetic. If we ignore that, we do so at our peril. And we become just a gathering of people who share and exchange pleasantries and interesting words. And I think we're better than that. And so I encourage us once again to look into your hearts and identify those causes, to connect with other individuals, to form those voluntary associations, and together let us further the blessings of creation. So may it be.